with us throughout this week is none other than Pastor Gemane Gete, and he's been joining us all the way from Liberia. And my Pastor Muruti, it's been a wonderful time to be in this place and paying attention and following on this wonderful series that's so relevant and timeless for the season we are in and the crisis we are going through, that in the midst of all the challenges, there is grace that is galore. We can never exhaust the grace of God. And to our friends that is following on the YouTube as well as on the Facebook, this is the time, and you are also more than welcome. And without any further ado, Muruti, I just want to hand over this time to you. May the Lord bless you and use you in a mighty way. Over to you, Muruti.
Amen. Thank you so much. And I'm excited that I have been privileged to join you all in studying God's word and praying through the entire week. It's quite a blessing, and I give God the glory for this great opportunity. As you know, the theme of this week's series is grace galore, grace in profusion, grace in abundance. We're talking about immeasurable, incalculably great grace of God. And this study has been based on the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter number 2, verses 8 to 10. And this profound passage of scripture actually teaches us six great truths about our salvation. We learn from the passage that we are saved by grace. We are saved through faith. We are saved as a gift. We are saved not of works. We are saved for God, and we are saved unto good works. Amazing truth indeed. Today, our focus is on the topic, the practice of the saved. The practice of the saved. And our key text is from the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10. As you flip the pages of your Bibles to this wonderful passage of scripture, may I inform you that I believe in the supremacy of the Bible. I believe that the Bible is not just the supreme authority or ultimate authority, it is the sole authority on matters of faith and practice. I also believe the sufficiency of the Bible, that this book is sufficient to make us wise unto salvation. And finally, I believe the summation of the Bible, or the totality of the scripture. I believe that all scripture comprising the Old and the New Testaments only, and 66 books only, is God's inspired word. So based on this affirmation of our belief in the Bible, we want to read now Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10. The Bible says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Our subject this morning is the practice of the saved. The practice of the saved. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the blessing of Bible study. As we study your word together, we ask that the Holy Spirit, who inspired your word in its entirety, will illuminate Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, and give us insight for living. And as it has pleased you to use a frail, filthy, and feeble vessel as myself, I do not ask for mighty words of human wisdom to move the audience. All I ask now, O Lord, is that humanity will diminish and that divinity will dominate as you speak to us pointedly, powerfully, and personally in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Our topic is the practice of the saved. the practice of the save. So today we'll basically be looking at the manner of the masterpiece. In our previous study, we looked at the maker of the masterpiece, the making of the masterpiece, and the makeup of the masterpiece, the workmanship of God. Our focus today will be on the manner or the practice of the masterpiece. Basically, we'll focus on three important points: the purpose of this new creation we talked about on yesterday, the preparation of this purpose, and the practice of this purpose. So let's go into our study of God's word now as we consider, first of all, the purpose of this new creation. The purpose of this new creation. Notice what the Bible says here in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works." For good works. So we see our word again, for. Okay, but now the word used here is actually a P, which literally means upon or unto good works. Upon or unto good works. And this indicates the God glorifying goal of our salvation. Now the text is good works. Now, the word work there describes that which displays itself in activity of any kind, and so refers to deeds or so. Now, good is used here as an adjective, agathos, as it is in the Greek, and it means profitable or benefiting, others. Whereas the related word kalos means constitutionally good, but not necessarily benefiting others, since are made adequate and equipped for agathos, which is work towards God and toward others. Now, good works used here in this text clearly is the object to which the new creation looks. According to one writer, God's purpose for this new creation is to have a vehicle through whom he might work, So we are, or we were, saved to serve. And very quickly, I will share with you that there are 10 things that believers are to do with good works. 10 things that believers are to do with good works. Number one, believers are to put on good works. Believers are to put on good works. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. Number two, believers are to prosper in good works. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 18. Number three, believers are to be prepared for all good works. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 17. And number four, believers are to be a pattern of good works. Titus chapter 2, verse 7. Number five, believers are to zealously pursue good works. Titus chapter 2, verse 14. Number six, believers are to preserve good works. Titus chapter 3, verse number 8. Also in Titus chapter 3, verse 14, you find this idea of preserving good works. Number seven, believers are to provoke good works. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 24. And the Bible also teaches in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, that believers are to project good works. And then the Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, believers are to promote good works. And then the Bible tells us in John chapter 10, verse number 32, that believers are to practice good works. And finally, friends, believers practicing good works is also taught in chapter 9, verse number 36 of the book of Acts. Those are the things we do with good works according to the word of God. So we have seen, brothers and sisters, the purpose of the new creation to be the channel, the conduit through which God would accomplish good works. The Holy Spirit would actually foster good works. Now let's consider our next point, the preparation of this purpose. Notice what the text says in chapter 2, verse number 10 of the book of Ephesians. The Bible says, which God prepared beforehand. Which God prepared beforehand. Now, this is the very powerful statement. Prepared beforehand simply means God made ready beforehand. It means to ordain before, to make ready in advance, or to be made ready beforehand. Now, when is beforehand? It's important. When is beforehand? I think Paul gives us a clue in chapter 1, where he says that God chose us in him, that is in Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be, take note of these words, holy and blameless before him. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. God prearranged, listen to me, a sphere of moral action for believers. Please take note of that. God prearranged a sphere of moral action for believers to walk in holiness without which no one will see him. So this is very important. Listen to this, friend. Faith is the means by which we are saved. It is by grace we are saved. But faith alone, as we know, justifies, but faith alone is not alone. Let me say it another way. The faith by which we are saved, it is by faith alone that we are justified, but faith is not alone. Faith alone justifies us, but not the faith which is alone. John Calvin phrases it very similarly. He says, it is faith alone that justifies, but faith that justifies can never be alone. Listen, my friend. So what did God prepare? What are the good works? Listen, my friend, good works are God's commandments of love, which are the transcript of his character, the obedience of faith, or faith that works by love. Good works are works done in gratitude for justification, not works done to gain justification. Good works are works done in gratitude for justification, not works done to gain justification. God prearranged that we would reflect his character, his image, by obedience to his law. Why his law? Because the Bible says his commandment is good. Romans chapter 7, verse number 12. Therefore, the law is holy, and the commandment holy and just and good. Why good works? The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 8. But we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully. Brothers and sisters, the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith. I can go on and on. For the Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves God is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Love summarizes the commandments, and love is the very nature of God. No wonder the commandment then is the transcript of the character of God. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, the Bible says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. The Bible says in John chapter 14, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Brothers and sisters, what is it that God prearranged before the world began? God prearranged a sphere of moral action, the obedience to his commandment. By keeping God's commandment, we demonstrate our love for God. brothers and sisters, I need you to note that indeed the commandments are the transcript of God's character. Psalm 19 verse 7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. So the law is the transcript of the nature or the character of God. The commandments are unchangeable, just as God's character is unchangeable. And God carved his love in stone when he gave the Ten Commandments. Why do I say this? Because they're summarized by love. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, Jesus says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And this is the first and great commandment. He continues, the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So the 10th commandments are the transcript of God's character. When we keep the first four commandments, we demonstrate love for God. For instance, if we love God, we will be number one in our lives. And if we make God number one in our lives, we are keeping the first commandment, which is the fundamental principle of love. If we love God, brothers and sisters, we will worship him and reserve worship for him alone. And if we reserve worship for God alone, we have kept the second commandment, which is the focus principle of love. If we truly love God, we will respect and reverence his holy name. And if we do that, we have fulfilled the third commandment, which is the frivolous principle of love. Brothers and sisters, if we love God, we will anxiously keep our appointment with him each Sabbath. And if we do that, we are fulfilling the, you know, fourth commandment, which is the faithfulness principle of love. And yes, indeed, if we love our neighbors, we will keep the remaining six commandments, oh, my brothers and sisters. If we love our neighbors, we respect and honor our parents. And if we do that, we have fulfilled the fourth commandment, which is the family principle of love. And then if we love our neighbors, we will value life. And by valuing life, we fulfill the, you know, sixth commandment, which is the felony principle of love. If we love our neighbors, we will preserve morality. And if we do so, we have fulfilled the seventh commandment, which is the fidelity principle of love. If we love our neighbors, my friend, we respect the property of others. And if we do that, we are simply fulfilling the, you know, eighth commandment, which is indeed the fraud principle of love. Brothers and sisters, I want you to know that if we love our neighbors, we'll be honest in our relationships with each other. And if we do that, we are indeed fulfilling, you know, the ninth commandment. And if we do that, brothers and sisters, we are fulfilling the false witness principle of love. And finally, brothers and sisters, if we love our neighbors, we will not covet that which belongs to our neighbor. And if we do not covet, we are fulfilling the 10th commandment, which is, brothers and sisters, the fulfillment principle of love. No wonder, brothers and sisters, the Bible teaches us that love is the fulfillment of the law. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Brothers and sisters, let's look at the last point in our study today, the practice of this purpose. The practice of this purpose. See what the Bible says. It says that we should walk in them. That we should walk in them. What does this mean? That expression, that we, literally can be translated in order that in them we might walk. And the word walk that is used in that text actually is from peri, which is about or around, and pateo, which is to walk or to tread. And you can translate that as to go here and there or to tread all around. The simple term you can translate that into is to exhibit or to make it a behavior. We are to walk in them. We are to walk in what? In good works, which God prepared beforehand. We have to walk in them. As we close this message, I want you to hear me, believers, that we are told in scripture of our walk with God. We are to walk in them. Now, in them is actually the locative of spear in the Greek. And it means we are to order our behavior within the sphere of these good works. We are to order our behavior within the sphere of these good works. Now, what are we to do? The Bible teaches us in Ephesians about our walk. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 2, the Bible tells us about our previous walk. We walked according to the course of this world before. But then the Bible also teaches us in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, about our present walk. We are to walk in them, in good works. Now, the Bible also teaches us about, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, about our privileged walk. We are to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we are called. The Bible also teaches us in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 2, okay, the Bible tells us about our prohibited walk, Brothers and sisters, it tells us that we should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles, do. We should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles do. And then the Bible teaches us in Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 2, about our passionate walk. We should rather walk in love. The Bible also teaches us in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8, that we have our projection walk. We are to walk as children of light. The Bible then teaches us about our prudent walk. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15, it says, "See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." And finally, brothers and sisters, the Bible tells us that we are to walk in all of these things. And what does this mean? Walking in good works is working out what God is working in. It is the fruit of the Spirit. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 to 13, the Bible says, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do his good pleasure." Yes, indeed, friends. God, under the new covenant, has carved his love in our hearts. This is the basis and the very instrument and the very foundation of good works. For the Bible says in Ezekiel 36, verses 26 to 27, that he gave us a new heart, a new spirit. He has removed the heart of stone and has put in the heart of flesh. His spirit is within us. Therefore, we walk according to his commandments. This is called spirit-inspired righteous living, spirit-inspired good works. Yes, friends, we are to walk in the commandments of God. That's the meaning of walking in good works. In Luke 1:6, the Bible says, "And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and requirements of the Lord." So walking in good works has to do with walking in the commandments of the Lord. In Colossians 1:10, the Bible says that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Listen, friend, listen indeed to this. According to Martin Luther, our works do not generate righteousness. Rather, our righteousness in Christ generates works. We are not saved by works. We are saved unto good works. The Holy Spirit, who is the earnest of our salvation, bears in us the fruit of the Spirit. Let me close with these words from the inspired pen of Ellen White. She says in Steps to Christ, page 58, very powerful statement. "Those who become new creatures in Christ Jesus will bring forth the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance." Galatians chapter 5, 22 and 23. "They will no longer fashion themselves according to the former lust, but by the faith of the Son of God, they will follow in his steps." reflect his character and purify themselves even as he is pure. Now, here's the final statement from Ellen White. This is so powerful. Ellen White says in Steps to Christ, page 61, we do not earn salvation by our obedience, for salvation is the free gift of God to be received by faith, but obedience is the fruit of faith. Brothers and sisters, we conclude our study of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10, with this profound call to Spirit-inspired obedience. Will you receive the gift of God today, the free gift of salvation, that he might empower you to walk in the good works which he prepared beforehand that we should walk in? Will you embrace Jesus as the Lord and Savior today? This salvation is so great. This grace is galore. It's abundant. It's profuse. It's incalculably great. It is immeasurable. This is amazing grace. This is extravagant grace. Will you receive the abundant, soul-saving, life-changing grace of God?
Amen.
Let us pray. Father, thank you for your people. Thank you for your word. Bless us indeed, as you have done all through this week. As we end this series, God, I pray that souls will be saved, that people will respond to your great grace. Now the Lord bless you and keep you, friends. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen.